So welcome to week two of the Metaphysics of the Beatles, a series that's not just exploring the different players in this iconic group and the gifts that they brought to this historical music that still, after 60 years, is the number one seller of any other group or artist ever. They have, like, by double or triple. So even the Michael Jacksons and the other iconic people that have come along in the last 6 years have not even been able to touch the records that they continue to break. But we're using this as also a reflection back to understand our own different levels of being and what they represent and how, when we have them in perfect harmony and balance, the amazing things that we can produce. I asked you last week to imagine what it would be like if your body was in perfect condition and anything you wanted to do, you could go out there and do it with ease. And you had this divine connection and understanding and thoughts that really enlivens you to fulfill some purpose or passion in your life. And you had the enthusiasm and the energy emotionally to bring all that you needed into being in order to do that. And all of this was being guided by the very highest spiritual part of you, which I call love. That love is what is pushing this out. Love of what you want to give to the world. Love of what you want to experience in the world. What would that look like? Maybe you've had little windows when every cylinder seemed to be firing, you know, and working in harmony together. But oftentimes that's not necessarily the way we experience life. Some of it might be going great, but then we might have some little challenges here or there with other parts of our experience. One of the things that I discovered in my research that I shared last week was, and I think it was really integral in the reason why they were so successful for that really short 6 years that they were together, is that they, from the very beginning, had an agreement that anything that they chose to do, everyone had to agree to it. If one person had an issue with it, if one person didn't want to go in that direction, then they wouldn't go. So every part of the band had to say yes to move into whatever direction that they did. And we also see what happens when that agreement breaks down, because as soon as one decided, no, it's important enough to me that I'm going this direction, even if none of the rest of you want to follow me there, then we see a lot of challenge. We see the disharmony that can come as a result. So we started with Ringo last week as representing the physical part of us, the heartbeat, if you will, the rhythm that moves through each of us, sometimes flowing and bouncing along, and we're able to, you know, be able to use that physical part to live into the moment, to be fully present in the moment. And we saw that you don't have to be the star. In fact, the body's, mine has never really been the star of the show. I'm happy when it supports me in all that I want to do, but, you know, I'm not a supermodel where this is my product right here. And so we want to, when it's not that way, we don't always spend the time that we need to really love and appreciate our bodies. In fact, you know, usually it's kind of like the afterthought, you know. At least for me, that's been one of the struggles in my life, is not really, I keep pushing it and asking it to do everything I need to do, but I don't always give it the rest that it needs, or the right nutrition that it needs, or the quiet time that it needs. We want this physical earth suit just to do whatever we want to do, and we don't have to pay much attention to it. But what Ringo reminds us of, what our physical aspect of being reminds us of, is that we have to love and appreciate that as much as we would love and appreciate our minds, or as much as we would love and appreciate the emotional connections that we have with people, or even as much as our spiritual lives. So we want to take time to do that so that it is there as the support Not necessarily the solo, but it is the support for all the other parts of our being. Today, we're looking at John Lennon, which represents the intellectual part, the intellectual aspect of who we are. And John is probably one of the most well-known members, he along with Paul McCartney. He was the founder. He was one of the primary songwriters, co-songwriter. He was a co-lead vocalist. He was a rhythm guitarist. And he was, in many ways, central in the formation of this group called the Beatles. And he went on to have, at least for whatever lifespan he had left, and it was cut short, sadly, he went on to continue to follow his own path in music. Lennon is often characterized by his rebellious nature and his acerbic wit. You will see that in a lot of the lyrics. They like to poke fun at life, at our humanity, at some of the events going on in the world. He was also a writer. He was an artist. He created films and wanted to, in fact, the Beatles were some of the first that ever created musical films, putting their music to images. And it certainly showed up, that wit and some of that acidity, when he was doing interviews. His songwriting partnership with Paul McCartney remains probably the most successful in all of history. Metaphysically, John represents that intellectual aspect of our own being. Intellect, on its own, is really only interested in the facts. It's only interested in trying to discern, and especially trying to discern what's happening out there. And it tends to take a sort of prove it attitude, you know, sort of the scientific attitude of, you know, I'll believe it when I see it. Charles Fillmore, one of our co-founders, he writes this, that the intellect is not wise. I want you to hear that. Even in its most prolific and profound thinking, it doesn't automatically have wisdom running through it. Wisdom is not its office. Intellect is the executive officer of wisdom and can do right only when faithfully carrying out the instruction of its principle. Intellect follows the letter of the law. And it's hard for the intellect to realize what he called the spiritual I am that I am, what we might call that Christ presence within us and within others. The intellect is always arguing back and forth until it gets to some level of understanding or in its mind proof that it is the highest authority. So people who live wholly in the intellect deny that man can know anything about God because they do not have the empirical, physical proof, and they don't trust this level of faith and divine inspiration that shows up for them. The intellect cannot grasp or even tolerate the mysteries of the mystical. It takes a whole nother set of faculties in order to be able to delve into that which is, some might call, unknowable, or at least unknowable in this two-dimensional or three-dimensional world that we live in. Nor is the intellect able to grasp deep and often illogical emotions of the heart. The intellect, you know, we talked about paradoxes, and that's one of the aspects of this higher evolution, this both and, that this can be true and this can be true, even though they seem opposite when we're looking at it as yes and no, black, white, right, wrong. That it's both. For the intellect, that's a no-go. It can't live in that realm because It says it's one or the other. That's the intellect lives in, it's either true or false, it's right or wrong, it's yes or no. So this mystical part where there isn't that same level of duality happening, that it's some other dimension where it's hard to even grasp that all of this can be unfolding at the same time, struggles. It often tends to dismiss it. For John, you can see this evidenced in different times in his life, but one of probably the most dramatic times is when the whole band, and I shared last week that they had gone to see the Maharishi in India. The whole band went. This was, you know, the late 60s, and this new way of experiencing life had just been arising amongst many, especially of the young generation. And George had connected very deeply with this and was wanting to bring the rest of his bandmates into that experience. And instead of opening and just experimenting with what this was like to be in meditation, to hear the words of someone who, at least from the perspective of that moment, was speaking truth from a higher realm than the intellect, John, he wasn't going to have any of it. He just wanted to argue with the Maharishi. He's like, prove it to me. Give me, you know, show me, you know, let me, you know, understand this intellectually when it was near impossible to do. He questioned him, and then ultimately, when he couldn't get the proof that he thought he should have in order to buy into this way of experiencing life, he labeled him a fraud and left. When we look at the Bible and the way the different aspects of being show up, we can see very clearly that intellect is not the same as wisdom. That intellect on its own cannot necessarily discern from that place of wisdom. And wisdom is that blending of the heart along with the thoughts. It is that perfect blending of understanding and compassion in the same moment. We see wisdom, and oftentimes in biblical references, the one who's considered the most wise, especially in the Old Testament, is Solomon. And in Solomon, in fact, that's all he asked for. God said, I'll give you whatever you want, and he says, give me wisdom. And wisdom is that place where our spiritual, our emotional, and our intellectual are all moving in the same direction, along with the physical giving us that way to experience it. And we see what happens when we're disconnected from those other levels of being, and only the intellect is running the show. And those are most often represented by the Pharisees and the Sadducees that we see in the New Testament. They are wholly concerned with writing and judging and enforcing the laws, where wisdom is wholly concerned with compassion, with kindness, with love, and with wanting to do the right thing out of that energy, irrespective of what society or the laws may say is the right or wrong thing to do. And oftentimes, as we see with these, what later became the authority in the Jewish community, they believed themselves not only to be the ones and the only ones that could enforce the laws, they also saw themselves as above the law, oftentimes. And the law was the only thing that mattered. It didn't matter who the person was, what their reasoning might have been, where their heart might be telling them. It was like, no, it's just black or it's white. And if you did it, then here's the punishment. And if you don't do that, then here's the punishment. And that's the way they saw their creative maker. And it's been a journey for a long, long period of time for us to understand that the intellect does not reflect the intellect or the aspects of being of that which created us. It is through the intellect, and it's an important part of the complete package of who we are, that we can think, that we can perceive mentally, that we can reason. And we develop our intellect by observation and by experience, aided by books and teachers. So it's an important part. It helps us put into context how we are perceiving and engaging in the world. And yet, if it's not guided by our heart, if it's not led by our spiritual, intuitive guidance, it can perpetuate the very same thing that it is judging as right or wrong. In fact, we almost become the very thing that we're railing against. And I thought about this with John Lennon, and so this is one of the interesting dynamics of the intellect in play without balance of the other thing, and this is about the peace movement that was coming. You know, John Lennon was at the forefront of all we are saying is give peace a chance and having sit-ins and all kinds of other things. But see what the intellect is saying about this and what that energy is of the intellect when we watch this short interview.
The only reason, if I'm going to get on the front page, I might as well get on the front page with the word peace.
But you've made yourself ridiculous.
To some people, I don't care.
If
it saves lives.
You don't think you... Oh, my dear boy, you're living in another Netherlands.
Well, you talk to them.
You don't think you saved a single life.
It didn't do a bit of use.
No,
it's still gone down, so it didn't do anything.
But, I mean, you don't equate... of the civil war that's going on in Nigeria with that, then talk about, well, this is my form of protest because people in anti-war campaigns are too serious.
Yes.
And they get battered. What do you know about a protest movement anyway?
I know a lot about it.
It's a lot more than sending your chauffeur in your car back to Buckingham Palace.
You're just a snob about it. The only way to make...
You're a fake. I know in England it's kind of smart not
everything
to be too serious about everything.
Everything needs a smile, you know.
I see.
For instance, even if...
The Pinkville Massacre, ha ha ha. Can't you give up something else that would mean a little bit more?
It doesn't, it's not the sacrifice. You can't get that into your head, can you? You've stated a half a dozen times the MBE is irrelevant. I agree. It was no sacrifice to get rid of the MBE because it was an embarrassment.
Then what kind of a protest did you make?
Advertising campaign for peace.
Very
can you understand
one.
That?
No, I can't.
A very big advertising campaign for peace.
And self-aggrandizing.
Well, you think
are
it's...
you advertising
oh,
John
do you
Lennon
want,
or
do
peace?
You want nice middle-class gestures for peace?
Maybe.
And intellectual
it's
manifestos
in
written by a lot of half-witted intellectuals and nobody reads them.
Oh.
That's the trouble with the peace movement.
Well, it just seems another Netherland. I mean, I can't think of anyone who seems more remote from the ugliness of what's happening than you.
Well, I
do see you getting up on a Tuesday morning and thinking, let's see, what should we do today and what war is going on?
Well, that's your imagination, you know, really.
You know, you carry on. Why don't you make a film on it, at it?
I'm someone who admired you very much.
Well, I'm sorry you liked the old mop tops, dear, and you thought I was very satirical and witty, and you liked Hard Day's Night, love, but I've grown up, but you obviously haven't.
Have you?
So here they are talking about peace. What was the energy that you got in there? You know, he's promoting world peace, but he promoted peace from a place of anger. From a place of upset, from a place of judging and blaming others about what it was. And that's so interesting to me. That's such an interesting dynamic of our humanity, that oftentimes we are so impassioned about something, but that which we are impassioned about, we are not demonstrating at all. We are simply, you know, telling other people about how it should be, and yet we're showing up. You know, we want to champion love, but how are we showing up in the face of hate? Are we showing up with a mirror of that? Are we showing up with the energy of love? And I think that's where the intellect can sometimes lead us astray, because the intellect will want to argue, will want to prove why you're wrong, will want to, you know, and it will stay in that energy until you either get so upset, you know, the person gets so upset that they walk out, or you somehow believe that the other person is now coming to see. But typically, when you're attacking in the same way, it's going to be pretty difficult to convince somebody else the true value and the true power of peace to be a transforming power. So here's what I want you to remember about this. The intellect thinks, the intuition knows. Think about that. The intellect thinks, but the intuition is what gives you that sense of knowing. You don't have to argue about it because you know. You don't even have to know or think and have a way to justify it or to explain it. You just know. The intellect aspires. The intuition inspires. The intuition provides the divine ideas, and it is there, and when we're in good balance, to have the intellect serve, to be able to take those ideas and move them into a physical expression along with our emotional being. The intellect is a magnificent aspect of our being, but not when it's the leader. It is best when we can make it that which serves our own intuitive and spiritual nature. Our imaginations can fuel a beautiful vision of what is possible. We can create. These words that he wrote are inspiring to know that that might be possible. And yet, left to its own guidance, it's busy jumping from idea to idea, and much of the time dwelling simply on the conditions of the world at large, rather than in that place of possibility. To integrate it with our own spiritual wisdom, with our thoughts, with our emotional body, there has to be sometimes of silence. The intellect, and this is how many of you, that's your biggest challenge in meditation, is getting your brain to slow down. Yeah, some people have both hands raised up. Yes. And it's really that it is the challenge, and it is the opportunity to give the intellect a rest and to tell it for just these little bit, you're not in charge. It thinks it's in charge most of the time, if not integrated with all the other parts of who we are. And so one of the best ways that we can train, if you will, bring into balance that aspect of our being is to allow ourselves to find times to be in silence. I don't care if you're meditating in a specific way or not, just to be in silence. Sometimes nature is a beautiful way to do that. Sometimes having a practice where you turn everything off and you just sit in the silence in your own space, that allows that resetting and rebalancing of that aspect into our lives. You know, one of the most iconic and beautiful, I guess, should we just not do this one? Because you already did Imagine. I was going to do that in my talk. We'll just skip. Huh? He does it better? Well, it's only a minute, so let's show this, because we keep shifting music around depending on who we've got to support. But again, this is probably one of his most iconic songs. And it is a reflection of how our intellect, when it's integrated with all parts of ourselves, can create some really beautiful, positive images and changes in our life.
Imagine all the people living life in peace. You may say,
imagine the possibility, then it can be true.
Yes, if you can imagine it. And you begin to bring all parts of your being into that imagination process, then we can achieve it. Seems a little impossible when you just look at the external world, but in the realm of imagination, guided, informed, and inspired by our own divine wisdom, it's possible. So as we look to practice this in our own lives, to bring this aspect of our own beings into greater alignment, being centered in our heart, being centered in that awareness of this current of love that runs through every aspect of our universe, and opening to our own spiritual wisdom, it allows us to help guide this beautiful aspect of our being called the intellect. It helps us bring something that is a balanced reflection of all parts of us into greater expression. It helps us live in that place of harmony, as the Beatles were able to do, even for that short window so many years ago. So that seemed like a good place to start today, to have that time where we can just simply be centered, that time where we can, for just a few moments, say peace, be still. So you can look at this. This is out of the Peace Chapel at Unity Village. This is what's up on the wall there. Or you can close your eyes as we move into this time of meditation, whatever works better for you. To bring your full awareness, not just to your mind and your thoughts and the amazing things that our intellect can bring into being, but also recognize that there is this spiritual energy alive within us too. This energy that connects us to all of life and is always seeking, whispering into our mind's eye what might be possible in any given moment. And expressed through our emotional being, that spiritual essence of us as divine love. All finding their home in this moment, in this thing that we call our body. So I invite you for just these next few moments, quietness of this time, simply guide, repeat, hold in mind and heart this idea of peace. Be still. Breathe into peace. Feel your body relax. Breathe into peace. Feel your energetic body. Some might call the aura expanding. Breathe into peace. Feel your heart opening wider and wider as a vortex of divine love. Don't try and process this experience, just allow it to be. And as you bring your attention back to this time and to this space, know that this center of peace, this place of perfect harmony and balance, that still small core at the center of every hurricane and at the center of our own being, is always right here, waiting for us to step inside. And it is from this place of peace that those infinite possibilities, that the inspiration that continues to drive us to strive towards it is alive and moving through us. And if we find ourselves being battered about again in the outer world, we come back to this place where all we need to know is peace. Be still. So as you bring your attention back, feel your body, perhaps even wiggling your toes and fingers. Feel the breath going in and out of your lungs. Feel this place of peace in your mind and this place of divine love flowing through your heart. And know that you too are an instrument of great blessing here to share them with our world. And whenever you're ready, you can open your eyes. So as we learn to love our bodies, which is a journey in itself, at least for some of us, and we open the door to our creative and to the important work of spirit with a solid foundation, a solid way to help inform our thoughts and to guide that emotional part of our being, we can truly become what the mystics called centered in God, centered in truth, and live from that place. As we listen to our own inner wisdom, that still small voice that was, as it was described by the poets in the Bible, we saturate our intellect in the divine. It begins to be informed from a new way and a new understanding of what life really is, and bring about ideas that don't just transform us to help us live more comfortably, but transform us to have us live more authentically from who we truly are. Our minds, when they're directed from our inner world rather than the events and experiences and the information that we gather from the outer world, are where the transformation lies for our own individual lives. It is the place where they were able to create this amazing music. So this is all about harmonizing and balancing and bringing forth the very best of every part of who we are. We're going to still continue on looking at Paul and looking at George, the emotional and the spiritual part of our being, and allow them and allow all that we learn to take us not just into a new place in our world, but into a new place in our universe. Well, it is our opportunity now to share of our tithes, our gifts, and our love offerings. And we're just grateful for the many ways in which we receive our good. As Madeline said, our prosperity is not always just about the financial flow in and out of this community, but it is about the way that people support us with their time and with their talents and with their ideas and with their energy to continue to navigate through this very different time in our world. We are coming out of this pandemic. We are now realizing that we're going to live permanently both in this virtual world as well as in this physical world, and we're just figuring out how to do that the very best we can. I am so grateful to the people who have been watching online, because I know for the people who have come here, it It's been pretty good. You know, even if nothing was working quite right, you could still have a pretty good experience. Online, it hasn't always been the case, and that you're still continuing to tune in each and every week and be hopeful that it will be a better experience each and every time. We're grateful. We're grateful for your steadfastness and for the ways that you steadfastly support this community. So let us take what we're offering today, or the energy of that, if we give through our online vehicles, into our hands and into our hearts, and join and bless it together. Divine love, through me, blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive.
Well, thank you so much for everyone joining us. Who are we doing next week? Paul is next week. So everybody come back next week. We're going to do music by Paul next week. It'll be exciting. Why don't you all stand up and let's do our peace song.
Protection guides us through this week and helps us stand strong in all of our fears. Let's say it together. The light of God surrounds us. I am the light of God. The love of God enfolds us. I am the love of God. The power of God protects us. I am the power of God. The presence of God watches over us. I am the presence of God. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Have a beautiful week. Come join us for some snacks in Fellowship Hall.